somebody talk to Martha Brown. Player. Tamara, sing it with us. Okay, I'm sorry. It's 5 after. All right. Don't sing it. And the praise of the Lord. Thank you. gonna give it to you.
I'll give it.
Said I'm gonna give it to you.
I'll give it.
Said I'm gonna give it to you.
I'll give it.
Said I'm gonna give it to you.
I'll give it.
Said I'm gonna give it to you.
I'll give it.
I offer it up, Lord.
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 I'll give it.
Come on, somebody give it to him. worship him, worship him. Ain't nobody like Jesus. Ain't nobody like Jesus. Ain't nobody like Jesus. Ain't nobody like Jesus, no. Ain't nobody like Jesus, no. No, 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 no.
Hallelujah. And on tonight, we welcome you tonight to the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries, where we come to remind you that Jesus is Lord. He's in control, and he has all power in his hand, and he will not and cannot fail. Hallelujah. Why? Because he is a God that sits high and looks low. Why? Because he is the big-breasted one. He comes to see about you at the point of your knees. And on tonight, we lift up our hands in the sanctuary, and we give him a praise, and we give him glory, and we give him honor, because he's been good to us. Hallelujah.
Yes.
We thank you tonight, God, for making a way. We thank you tonight for being good to us. We thank you tonight for healing our bodies.
Yeah.
We thank you tonight for giving us peace of mind. We thank you tonight. Hallelujah. When nothing else could help, it was Jesus. Hallelujah. So we worship him in his atmosphere. We bless him in his atmosphere. We call on his name in his atmosphere, because it's on the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. That every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he's Lord of lords, that he's King of kings, that he can do anything but fail. Hallelujah. Wherever you are in the building, come on and worship him. Hallelujah. Because he's Lord of lords. Hallelujah. Because he's King of kings. Why? Because he saves you. Why? Because he rescued you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's why we can say we exalt thee. Hallelujah. We exalt thee, oh Lord. Hallelujah. Just look at your neighbor and say, come on and help me exalt the Lord tonight. Come on and help me exalt the Lord on tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and exalt the Lord on tonight. Hallelujah. Right where you are, in your situation, begin to lift your hands and exalt him. Hallelujah. For keeping you when you couldn't keep yourself. That's why we say thank you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on and worship him, worship him. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. Right here in the same spirit, oh, Lord. Oh, Lord, 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 Lord. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It was the Lord that kept you in perfect peace. It was the Lord that kept your mind. It was the Lord that wrapped you in the cradle of his arms. Hallelujah. It was the Lord. Yes, it was. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and give him your worship. Give him your worship. So, Father, we come tonight for no other reason but to bless your name. To remind you, to thank you, God, to tell you how much we love you tonight, to tell you how much we appreciate you tonight, to tell you, God, thank you for being good to us, even when we weren't good to ourselves, oh God. You still loved us. You still loved on us. You still kept us. We say thank you tonight. We say thank you for wiping the tears away from our eyes, oh God. When nobody else knew and nobody else could come to our rescue, you still was there, right there with us. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We give you praise tonight. Now, God, be with us. Keep us. Touch our minds and our hearts. Open up our spirits so that we might hear what the Spirit is saying to the church on tonight.
Oh,
amen.
Love you, we need you, and in give God some praise in here? Amen. On a Wednesday night, come on, give God some praise. Give me a little help. Tomorrow when you get up there, give me a little help. Hallelujah. So we thank God, and we are excited to be here. Come on, somebody just shout hallelujah. Yeah. Come on, it's a Wednesday night. You ought to be glad to be alive. Hallelujah. And so we are thankful. We appreciate God. And so we are honoring Pastor Moss tonight and Lady Isabel. We thank God for them. Amen. I see Pastor Rhonda's in the house. Amen. And everyone here, we thank God for you. Love you so much. Appreciate you, Pam, coming in and standing in for Elder Craig. And we have him on the road. We want to keep him lifted in prayer. And so we're just thankful. Elder Alonzo's on the road. Thank you, sir. I don't think I'm going to sweat, but just in case. And so we're just keeping everybody covered in prayer. And before I go any further, let me just say Happy Thanksgiving. Amen, amen. Come on now, don't make me work hard tonight. It's been a rough week. I got in late and I've been working every day. Pam been working me like a Hebrew slave. Amen. And so so I've been working every day. And so it's been good though. But I believe the Lord has just dropped something in my spirit. Amen. For the house. So not only do I want to speak to you, but I want to speak to the atmosphere. I want to talk about the atmosphere that needs to be in a house so that we can continue to see God move the way we are in expectation. Amen. Thank God for my lovely wife who is back home in Jacksonville, Florida, and preparing dinner for her family. And so we thank God for them. Good to be here with my brother and my father and my son and daughters, all the folk that's here. I said daughter. And you're going to see everybody this week, everybody but MC. But we thank God for him. And so I'm just thankful. Thankful that the matriarch of our family is here. Amen. Amen. Aunt Sunset is here. My cousin is here with her. So we're just excited and just thankful. All right. So you don't have to stand, but let me just go right to the Word of God, Psalm 133. And then I'm going to read from John 17. 20 through 22 and just share with you. Amen. And I can just be myself. Somebody say, be yourself. I can just be myself tonight and just allow God to just speak to us. Psalm 133 simply says, King James, behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard. Thank you. That went down to the skirts of his garments as the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. Somebody say there. The Bible says, for there the Lord commanded the blessing. John 17:20 says, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me, and the glory which thou gavest me, I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Amen. Amen. Come on, y'all gonna wake up tonight, or we just gonna clap and go home? Amen. Somebody said amen to that too. Amen. I'm trying to get home for Thanksgiving dinner. Amen. So, Father, we just thank you for your word. Thank you for our hearts being open. God, we just ask that you allow us now to receive the engrafted word that is not only able to save our soul, but it takes us from faith to faith and from glory to glory. God, we love you so much. We need you. And even in this season, as we move toward the season of Advent, we stop and pause in this moment around the world to say thank you. God, not that we shouldn't give thanks every day, but in this specific time of year, people find a reason to say thank you. And so, God, we too want to celebrate your goodness and your glory. Regardless of what we've had to endure, you're still a good God. And so, God, we love you. We thank you. Let this word now move us, catapult us, spring us into something fresh and something new. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, yeah, that was it right there. All right. Come on, look at three people and say, I thank God I'm this connected. Come on, say that again. I thank God that I'm this connected. Amen. And so We are here. It's Thanksgiving Eve, and we're excited. We thank and we love God. So many things about Thanksgiving being seen on television, radio, and or heard on radio, social media, and other places, the good, the bad, the ugly. But there are so many thoughts and feelings surrounding Thanksgiving. Even with the race theory, we have some issues now with Thanksgiving because of what supposedly took place with the pilgrims. And then, of course, around Christian movements around the country, we're excited coming together because we're thankful to God and what he's done. And then in the secular world, it's been monetized and commercialized with Thanksgiving because of the festivities of harvest and all that's taken place. And it's so amazing that so much we have to be thankful for, but at the same time, there's a flurry of uneasy emotions that take place during these holidays. When Thanksgiving comes, it seems like there's a space between now and the first of the year where so many things come and begin to bombard our existence, things like melancholy and depression and despair because of things that have taken place in our lives and the bereavement that we've had to endure, or possibly just missing certain times that we've had in the past. And these emotions come up and they begin to strangle our expectation and our joy. But can I just stop for a moment, as I love to do every Thanksgiving, and cancel the deceit of the enemy? Can I just come tonight and say that I put a stronghold on the enemy's attempt to try to speak to our minds and to our emotions, to bring depression and despair and melancholy to us? And that can I loose now, by the Spirit of the living God, joy and peace and excitement about what God has in store for our lives? And that even in the midst of some stuff that has taken place, we still have a reason to say thank you. Yeah, I know it. I know it. Sometimes it's hard. I remember when my mom passed years ago, and I thought Thanksgiving would never be the same because she wasn't around. And to a great degree, it has not been the same. But you know what? God is still a good God. God is the type of God that blesses us in the midst of everything that we're going through, everything that we feel. And God gives you a reason to say thank you. I think you, if just like they tell us for your body, you ought to get up every morning, and before you do anything, they say you ought to drink a glass of water to get everything moving, to get the organs pumping and everything going. But I believe when you get up in the morning, the first thing you ought to do is just say thank you. Give God some praise. I just tell you right there, if you didn't do it this morning, you can do it right now. Come on. Tell him thank you for the breath of life. Thank you for being in my right mind. Thank you for the house of God. Thank you that I get to praise you. Thank you that I get to know you. You know it's a privilege to even get to know God. You know how many folk walking around here and don't know God? But the Bible says to them that know their God, they shall be strong and do great exploits. So isn't it good news that you know God? Somebody say, I'm thankful. Yeah, so it's good news to be thankful. It's good news to be in a proximity of people that understand the goodness of God, because during this time where we're supposed to be thanking God because he's given us a harvest, sometimes we're just reminded of hardships. And so it's good to come together. And so tonight, I want to talk about connectivity. I want to talk about the reason we're connected and why we should be connected and what happens when you have that type of synergy, when God allows you to be around saints and people that believe God. And so I'm just appreciative of what God is doing in our lives. The Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians 5 that in everything, give thanks. He didn't say in the good things. Come on, I see you, Pastor Mike. He didn't say when things were working out. He said in everything. When hell done busted loose, somebody say, I gotta thank him. When everything's going wrong, somebody say, I gotta thank him. When things didn't go the way I anticipated, somebody say, I gotta thank him. Because regardless of what's going down, the one thing that I can depend on is God is good. Yeah, he looked over creation and said, it's very good. And we can continue to trust in the fact that no matter what we're going through, we serve a good God. And so if you haven't noticed already tonight, in my tired body, when I say tired, somebody say he tired. Yeah, you know you're tired when you can't even spell it right. In his tired body, and let me stop and say thank you and God bless you to my bishop and Lady Narlene. They're in Memphis, Tennessee with Mama Jackson. And so we just want to say thank you and God bless you to them as they travel. And we just believe God. But tonight, I believe God brought me here to prophesy and to encourage somebody who just ridiculous enough to believe that coming around the corner, your best year is waiting ahead of you. Yeah, come to encourage some people that this thing is getting ready. Somebody say it's about to go down. Yeah, God is getting ready to bust a move in our lives. I believe that. I believe my next year is getting ready to be my best year. I just believe that. If it wasn't, he would have took me out long time ago. But because of the type of God that I serve, there's something in store for my life. I need five people in here to say hallelujah. Yeah, I need some ridiculous people that in the midst of turmoil, in the midst of bills not paid, in the midst of not feeling well, in the midst of things going on, you still got to jump in your spirit. You still got to leap inside your bones. Why? Because we know the Almighty God. I came to prophesy that it's getting ready to go down. Yeah, I've decided to live in the expectation of a glorious future, Mike. I believe that the plan and purposes of my God are getting ready to start. And somebody shout tonight. Tonight, I prophesy a new encounter with your purpose. I prophesy a new encounter with the passion of God in your life. That tonight, I just believe that every time I open my mouth, God's getting ready to do something miraculous. I just believe that he didn't get me off of dope. He didn't get me out of jail. He didn't get me from being a manipulator in order for me to just get up here and be a talking head. I believe there's an anointing in my mouth that every time I open it, something has got to shift. Something has got to change. That's why the enemy keeps coming after me the way that he does. That's why the attacks are so high. Why? Because God wants to use an old wretch like me to bring change to somebody else's spirit. Somebody say, I'm about to change. I'm about to change. God is getting ready to do something, and I believe that. First John says it like this: Beloved, now, somebody say now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. And I need to tell you that that's only the beginning. Who knows where we're going to end up? Listen, don't act like God can't turn your situation around tonight. Don't act like you can't go home and something doesn't happen. Don't act like you can't get no mail on Friday to tell you that your life has been changed forever. And for some of y'all that's still playing the lotto, don't act like you can't hit this weekend. Don't you act like God can't do something for you that will blow your entire mind. Somebody say, blow my mind. God. And I just want to prophesy and say this to you, and it's on the screen. My just wait and see looks better than my what you see. Yeah, did you hear me? My wait, just wait and see looks better than my what you see. Yeah, you might see me like this right now, but you don't know how I'm going to be riding tomorrow, Levi. You might see me written today, but you don't know what I'm getting ready to buy tomorrow. You just wait. Somebody say, just wait and see. Just wait and see. God is trying to do something for us, and I believe that there's a just wait and see that's on its way to bless my life. And so I come not only tonight with some level of apostolic authority in this house, but I come in my authority as a son. Do you know there's power being a son? Did you know that? There's power being a daughter. Did you know that? I don't know about you, but Lee Iacocca did all the work, but the baby Iacocca's got the spoil. Y'all didn't hear me. Carnegie did all the work, but the baby Carnegie's got all the spoil. See, sometimes it ain't about being the parent. It's about being the child. See, so tonight I come in the authority of a son. I come in the authority of my father. I come in the authority of my apostle who said to us, the manifestation of hidden treasures is on its way. Yeah. The manifestation of hidden treasures is on its way. Now, it doesn't come without a cost, but it's still coming. Yeah. I watched a documentary the other day. These gentlemen, and they had owned the railroad stations back in the late 1800s. And he had the only railroad stations that were moving in America. And he had billions and billions of dollars. And he was dying. He left the money to his sons. Now, there's no question that they squandered most of it. And so it was the Vanderbilts. And so eventually, Gloria, because of her education, became the icon in the fashion industry that she become. But see, her great granddaddy had already built a name for her that was going to get her in some doors that she couldn't have got in by herself. See, you could have been a McGuire, but you couldn't have got in that door. But because she was a Vanderbilt, yeah, I'm trying to help you to know that it's all right to be a son or a daughter tonight. Because see, there might be a fight that your natural father and your mother might have went through that'll bust open the door for you. And so when it's your turn to manifest, all you got to do is walk in your...
in your name. All you got to do is walk in the inheritance that God has given you. Somebody say manifestation. I believe manifestations are coming. Isaiah 45:3-6. Watch me slow down. And I will give thee the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that thou mayest know that I, the Lord, which called thee by name, am the God of Israel. Watch what he said. He said, for Jacob, somebody say Jacob. You know, Jacob, that's the crazy you. Yeah, that's the you before you got regenerated and holy and all pristine. That, somebody say, that's me when I'm crazy. Did you know that God didn't wait till you got right before he called you, but he called you while you was crazy? He said, for Jacob, my servant's sake, and Israel, mine elect, I have even called thee by name. Watch what he said. I have surnamed thee. See, women understand being surnamed, because when you get married, you lose your old name and you take on the identity now of your husband. Now, I'm not saying that being a Jones wasn't a good thing for my wife, but being a McGuire is something else. You see, because now she doesn't walk in her Jones-ism, she walks in her McGuire-ism. So whatever it was that I am, or whatever it is that I am, she gets to walk in the power of my name. And that's what God said. It doesn't matter who you were and what you were, I just surnamed you, so you got my name. So I ain't just Mark McGuire, I'm married to Jesus. So now my name is Marco Cristo. Yeah. I'm the anointed Mark now. I'm not just old Silk. I'm not just old Gucci. I'm Mark the anointed, because I get to walk in my daddy's name. Somebody say the name. So he said, I have even surnamed thee, thou that hast not known me. God did it before we were even an acquaintance with him. He said, I am the Lord, and there is none else. There is no God beside me. I don't care what they tell you on social media. I don't care what they tell you about the universe. I don't care what they tell you about transcendental meditation. I don't care what they tell you about mystical stuff. I don't care what they tell you about karma. The truth of the matter is, there is no other God besides him. He said, I girded thee, though thou hast not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, there is none else. And see, sometimes in order for us to truly understand that, God has to remove some stuff that you hold on to more than you hold on to him. You don't do it on purpose, but listen, I grew up in church. Yeah, my daddy was in the choir. You know, they don't have choirs no more. It's praise and worship team. But my daddy, my auntie, they was in the choir. The spirituals. The men's chorus. I even sang This Little Light of Mine. I'm gonna let it shine. And my mama was a missionary president. She was a Sunday school teacher. I learned how to read at 3.5, 4 years old, reading the King James Version with my grandma Lila. So I was around. My daddy was the first man I ever seen pray and read the Bible. I was around the Word of God. We had to go to church every weekend. If you didn't go to church, you didn't go nowhere during the week. Other than the dishes, church was almost like prison. If you don't do this, Jack, you ain't getting to do nothing else. I grew up around the Word. I ain't never seen my daddy smoke, drink. I ain't even know he cussed till he stepped in some dog doo-doo one time and the S word came out. I've never seen him sin. I didn't know that stuff existed from my house, but the world was able to draw me in, and the person that I esteemed the highest was my mother. But it wasn't until God told her to come home that I was able to see the Lord high and lifted up. And so for me, when she left, I thought I was going to lose my breath. But it was because God had to remove a barrier from my destiny that I actually gained my life. So sometimes we grieve over what we lost, but really it ain't a loss, it's a gain. Because if she wouldn't have left, I would have worshipped her rather than worshipped him. That's why God told, when Moses died, he said, give me the bones. Let me go hide these bones because I don't need the Israelites running over to his tomb worshiping him because I'll use him to bring them out of Egypt. I need them to worship me. Somebody say he'll hide some bones from you. He'll hide some bones from you. So God is saying that I am the Lord and there is none else. Let me say that on the other side of our enthusiastic obedience is the excellency of what I believe is special favor over our lives in this season. I believe increase and abundance and triumph and peace and joy and overflow. And even as I said, manifestation has been spoken. Watch what Job said. If they obey and serve him, they shall spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. You know, I tell both my boys all the time, listen. I know y'all so smart. I know you got it going on. I know you can get any job you want. And for my oldest son, I know you're slicker than me. I know you're smooth. I know you can work it out, Cam. I know you can get it. But let me tell you something. If you really want to spend, listen, it took me a long time to get here. But at 54, I'm getting ready to enjoy this life. Yeah, I'm getting ready to walk in my pleasures. I'm getting ready to understand what God has in store for me. Listen, I might have messed up 53 of them, but I ain't messing up the next 50. I'm getting ready to walk in. Why? Because the Bible says that if I want to spend my days in prosperity, that's the good success of God, and my years in pleasures, all I got to do is obey and serve him. And it doesn't even call for my perfection. It just causes for my heart to be perfect towards him. Understanding that my life is not about jobs and occupations and endeavors and dreams and aspirations. My life is about serving God. God pulled some things out and he told us that, listen, there's an eternal expectation coming, but it's all about your connection. It's all about being connected to God. Watch what God said in Numbers 23. God is not a man. Watch this. So he does not lie. He is not human. Watch this. I'm going to bless you. So he does not change his mind. Somebody in here tonight needs to know that it hasn't gone like you expected it, and you haven't even done it the way you were supposed to. But whatever God said to you, he has not changed his mind. He's not the type of man that would change his mind. Why could you trust a God that changes his mind? He doesn't change his mind. He changes his methods. And whatever he told Israel, listen, if you obey me, you'll live free. So somebody said, well, God changed his mind because they got caught by the Assyrians and the Babylonians. He didn't change his mind. They didn't obey. But when they came out, somebody say, but when they came out. But when they came out, they were better than when they went in. It might not have been the same generation, but he wasn't speaking to a certain people. He was speaking to a generation. So let me help some parents and some grandparents and some aunts and some uncles, that some of the promises that God has might not be for you, but it might be for your posterity. It might be for the people that are going to come behind you. And I tell you, you ought to want to live right enough now so that your children and grandchildren can walk in the promises of God. Don't be so selfish that you don't want to see what's behind you. Get what God has in front of you. I want my children to be able to experience the goodness and the pleasures of God because I tried to be obedient. So in our text, God promises to give his children treasures of darkness. That literally means things stored, put in a depository or a storehouse. Watch this. It means money or resources hid, or watch this, or laid up. Watch this. Due to ignorance, destruction, misery, and wickedness. You know what it says in Proverbs 13 in the B section of verse 22. And the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. So folk be getting mad at Kanye and all them that's getting this money. I look at somebody and say, get it. Because if you ain't right, it's coming to the kingdom. It might not all come to me, but it's coming to the king. Jay-Z, you don't want to love the Lord. I don't want you just to get 1 billion, get 10 billion. Because whatever you get, if it ain't with God, it's coming to the kingdom because that's the word. He told the children of Israel, listen, you're going to have houses you didn't build. You're going to have land you didn't cultivate. When you go over, when you cross over, I let them do that so they can prepare it for you. That's why we don't have to walk in jealousy. Somebody said, they're just getting it ready for me. You don't have to walk in jealousy, because whatever God has determined is coming your way. Tell somebody, it's coming my way. God's been hiding a portion of our stuff until the right time. And watch this. Some of this is on us. Until we can be responsible, intelligent, and knowledgeable about how to handle it and how to make it grow. I don't know if I can handle $10 million now, but I know I couldn't handle $10 million 10 years ago. $10 million 10 years ago would have been gone in 10 days. Did y'all hear me? Because I didn't know how to handle it or how to make it grow. But God's been saying, I need you to pay attention on how to handle what I give you and how to what I give you, how to make it grow. Somebody say, make it grow. See, and for us, we got kingdom principles. See, so not only do we plant it and invest it, somebody say, sow it. Yeah, I didn't get no real shout on that. Somebody say, sow it. The reason why most of our kingdom stuff don't grow is because we don't know how to sow. We so scared to release it, we can't get it. We so scared to not having it, we don't know how to let it go. It needs to tell somebody, need to leave as fast as it came. You need to learn how to sow, because you don't know out of which ground God's going to bring the harvest. You don't know what day it's going to rain. That's why the farmers in Jacksonville, they don't wait on the forecast. They just break up the fallow ground. I watched him talk to a man. He said, I throw seed down every time I can find some ground. I don't even worry about it, because you never know when a cloud is coming. You never know when the rain is going to pour. And it might not pour long, but somebody say, long enough. And so God has given us stewardship principles, and he's teaching us in our hearts so that we won't have any darkness. The text goes on to say, and I need to hurry, that there's hidden riches of secret places. There's no question. Can I get a little didactic for a minute? I want to speak to my students for a second. There's no question that this phrase can be ambiguous. The hermeneutic principle of double complexity could be utilized here for proper extension and interpretation. With our spiritual eye and the revelation of the Holy Spirit, we see that this hidden riches is Jesus, as the obscure truth or the true riches referred to in this text for the phrase hidden riches is translated from the Hebrew word that means secret and buried valuables. And we see that it shall come from secret places, hidden riches from secret places, a closed and covered concealed place. So as our source of truth, the Textus Receptus or the Bible, the canonized scriptures as we know them, our Bible is referred to in two parts. The Old and the New Testaments, keeping faithful to the Christocentric mandate and canonization qualifiers that in the Old Testament is Christ concealed, but in the New Testament is Christ revealed. So for us spiritually, he's saying that these hidden treasure in secret places, it came through the Old Testament 40 and two generations, and it revealed itself through the Virgin Mary in the person and the birth of Jesus Christ. But can I tell you something? That along with that, we must also honor what's known as direct translation, that our linguistic development has afforded us as we translate this formal equivalence from one language to the other, yet staying true not only in syntax, grammar, and context, yet making a word-for-word correlation from the original source writer and the current reader, which is us. The phrase then, hidden riches of secret places, actually and simply translate money that's been properly held until now. Yeah, y'all ain't gonna help me here. God has said, I got money, I got resources that's been held up, somebody shout, until now. And see, if I was at a different church, somebody would have threw a penny up here. If I was in a different church, somebody would have brought a bracelet up here. If I was in a different church, somebody would have said, I gotta get to whatever God's got for me, and for in order for me to get it, I got to sow. Somebody say, sow it. Yeah. If I was in a different place, somebody would shout hallelujah, because sometimes I ain't got to sow money. I need to sow a praise. I need to sow a shout. I need to sow a dance. I need to sow a clap. I need to do something that will aggravate what God's got in the ground. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. I guess, though, I'm at that one place where they don't need no money. I'm in that one place that don't need resources, that doesn't need a breakthrough, that doesn't need a blessing, because that's the problem with the body of Christ, that you get prompted and we don't move. We stand still and we give God a hallelujah. But when the Bengals are on, when the Steelers are on, when the Cowboys are on, when that team is on, we know how to shout. You shout in your house and ain't nobody else around you. You holler at the TV like they can hear you. But you get inside the house of God, the Word of God comes, the Holy Spirit moves, and you sit there like you ain't heard nothing. I'm getting ready to stop. I ain't doing nothing for about 30 seconds until somebody give God some praise. You ain't gonna make me sweat up in here, and you ain't gonna praise God. And God just told you he was gonna release the resources you've been looking for with your crazy self, with your disobedient self. God getting ready to bless you. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. I told one of my sons one time, I said, boy, my hallelujah got you that answer on that test. When you were sitting there and couldn't figure it out, it was your daddy running around the house shouting because you was at NYU and that revelation came and you answered that question. Somebody shout hallelujah. I really believe that when God says money, he's saying that which could be used to advance us. So not only money, but he's talking about essential resources that God is going to use in this season. Doors, people, avenues, platforms, mechanisms, business strategies, angelic assistance, Holy Ghost wisdom, grace manifestation, gifts, wealth, power gifts. Look, not just for liturgical service. I'm not talking about just worship utensils because we got too many toys in church now. But I'm talking about creativity. I'm talking about witty inventions. I'm talking about wealth strategies, fresh insight that uncovers old truths for new opportunities. I'm talking about economic empowerment inside the marketplace. And most importantly, somebody say a divine connection. Do you know you won hookup from your destiny? You won hookup from God taking you where you're supposed to go? You won hookup from God making you go from faith to faith and glory to glory? You don't know. You might be walking into your neck. You might be walking into your next springboard. Somebody say, I'm ready to leap into it. God's wanting to do something for us, but faith without works is dead. Somebody say, I know you're going to go crazy. Bishop, when you preach, you go crazy. If you know the hell I done put myself through and how good God done been to me, you act a fool too. You act like you ain't got no mind. I'm not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to be preaching. This used to be a crack pipe, and now it's a microphone. I can't tell you how thankful I am to God, and I'm going to act a fool for him until I can't breathe no more. So look at somebody and say, how about that? Deuteronomy 8:18 says, but you shall remember the Lord your God. See, that's why sometimes we got to go through stuff that man can't help us out of. Especially emotionally. You ever been in a place where your emotions is in your gut? Where you crying but you can't even cry, where it just hurt to be alive, like you wish you was dying but you can't die, that the hurt is so bad. God says, I let you get like that only because I wanted to get you out of that, so that no matter where you go, you won't forget about me. I done had a lot of people in my life and I done forgot most of them. I be nervous when I come home. People walk up on you, be like, hey, what's up, McGuire? Be like, I know I went to school with them, but I was high. I don't remember their name. You don't remember I helped you go to class. I got you and Spud out of getting in trouble. You helped me and I don't remember you. But I'll tell you one person I'm not going to forget. Sink it, Jesus. Give us another one. Sink it, Jesus, sink it. There she is right there. I've been preaching that for 20 years, and there's the woman right there with the pinky. Sink it. Somebody say, sink it, Jesus, sink it. Whenever I get in trouble, sink it, Jesus. Whenever I'm on the line, sink it, Jesus. Whenever I need a shot, sink it, Jesus. Why? Because I can depend on him. He gives you power to get wealth, that he might establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers. Did you hear what I said? That he might establish his covenant, watch this, which he swore to who? Your fathers. That's why it's good to be a son, because some of the stuff God gonna do for me ain't because of me. It's because of he loved Mickey. He loved Vaughn. He loved his sons who are my fathers. See, we lose. Somebody say connection. I'm going to get ahead of myself, and I need to hurry up. Pam got to go by 8:30. Last week, God gave me the green light for new organizations and holding companies for investment. Gave Lady Angela the green light for Commerce Institutes. The relaunch of the McGuire Foundation. Watch this. That's what God said to us. I said, get this stuff done. Get it fixed. Get the LLC. Get the incorporated. Get it all done. Get all the nonprofits. We got to get them 501c3. We got to do all of this. We need to move with urgency. Not panic, but it's getting ready to go down. Now, as I say this to you, I don't want you getting jealous about what's getting ready to happen for me, because I'm releasing it. I tell somebody, he's releasing it. Because there's something that God has put in you that I'm telling you, all you got to do is the framework and God gonna do the rest. See, sometimes God will frustrate your job. Sometimes God will frustrate your position. Sometimes God will frustrate the people around you. Why? Because he's got something else for you. And because you've been scared and disobedient and wouldn't walk in it, God said, I got to put you in a position that is either me or nothing. He's teaching us now. I mean, some people have been disobedient, but in most cases, God is teaching us that he wants us to have more. So, Bishop, what are you saying? I'm saying these are institutions of financial literacy and consultation, scholarships, financial securities and investment consultation, entrepreneurship, economic leadership, and biblical kingdom principles and stewardship that God is telling us to open, and I ain't got no money. I got more money in my pocket than I got in the bank. But he just told me to open up the McGuire Foundation and give away money. And he said, it's the reason, he said, get ready, because I'm connecting you. Somebody say, the power of connection. Genesis 1:28, the message says, God blessed them, watch this, prosper, reproduce, fill the earth, take charge, and then watch what he said, be responsible. This is the Adamic mandate from God. This is the original creation mandate. This is what God wants me to do. Somebody say, me to do. This is what God is telling us to do. This is good news. I'm always surprised why folk don't shout more in church. I have to constrain myself to hear everything that Bishop is saying when he's preaching, because he's talking about me. He's talking about me. He's saying God loves me so much that God wants to use me. See, y'all just ain't been nowhere. Y'all ain't done nothing wrong. You ain't slept with the wrong person. You ain't put the wrong thing in your mouth. You ain't never been nowhere you ain't supposed to been. You ain't got no bodies that might be yours. You ain't never done nothing. But see, for a guy like me, Oh, you don't understand what I'm talking about. I guess I got to go back to the prison ministry to get real shouts. So, cause when I preach in the prison, it go crazy because everybody in there know they guilty. Ain't no acquittal in there, but there's something about the goodness of Jesus that God said, when I get you up out of there, I'm getting ready to use. See, I think all y'all need to spend about 45 days in prison and somebody bring up something that you did that you didn't think nobody else knew, and then you got to serve your time for it and hear God preach to you, and you have to believe God while you're in there, and then when you get out, you see God starting to do it. It'll change your shout. Oh, okay, you ain't got to go to prison. Ain't nobody here ever been sick. You ain't never been what they call down south low sick, where you didn't know if this thing was going to turn around or not. This thing ain't never had you by your neck where you didn't know if God was going to move or not. And then all of a sudden, I thank God I done been on my deathbed. I done OD'd. I done had everything go on, and I've seen the power of God. And I said, God, I kept going through stuff. He said, because when I brought your mother home, you thought I wasn't who you thought I was. Because I didn't heal her your way. You thought that I wasn't who I said I was. So in order for me to prove to you that I am who I said I am, I had to let you go through it. But see, here's the good part. I had to go through it. You don't have to. I just need about 5 of y'all to believe me right now and just give God a praise. That might take your next sickness up off of you. That might take your next hardship up off of you. Oh, I believe you, Bishop. I'm with you, dog. I got you. What you said is true. He ain't got to show me. I believe it right now. Somebody say, I'm connected. Luke 19:13. What? Listen. Let me say this. Jesus spoke in prophetic parables. And he gave us the true positioning of kingdom believers. That as the redeemed, we should be managing and causing increase with what he left. That's supposed to be our job. Okay, you don't believe me. Luke 19:13, a couple of translations, King James. And he called 10 servants and delivered to them 10 pounds and said unto them, occupy till I come. And in NIV, he said, put this money to work until I come back. In the New American, he said, do business with this until I get back. Somebody say, I got a bag. In Luke 19:13, New Living, he said, invest this for me while I'm gone. In the ESV, he said, engage in business. Come on, until I come. In the Message, he said, operate with this until I return. And in the Amplified, he said, buy and sell with these while I go and then return. Slap 3 people and say, Papa, got a brand new bag. There's something that God wants to put in our hands. There's a gift, there's a resource, there's money. Listen, the word occupy literally means do the business of a banker. And we begging folk to help us pay our bills. I'm not saying that we're never going to be in need. I'm just saying we don't have to keep living below our privilege. Somewhere along the line, we're going to line up with stewardship in the way that God has ordained it, and we're going to begin to see the goodness of God flowing. Watch this. Not just to our lives, but through our lives. Come on, tell somebody, I want to be a lender. Every time somebody say, Bishop, can you? I'd be like, Lord, help me to be that. They ain't getting no, my wife say, I know you. They people get on your nerves always asking you for something. No, I just feel like God done showed them something that I ain't seen yet. It can pour out of me. Hey, I ain't got no problem with Mark National Bank. I ain't got no problem with giving you your mortgage money. And I don't have no problem being able to be what God wants me to be, because the quicker I can get it away, the quicker it can come back. But the horrible thing about us is that he gave us all an equal share. He gave you the amount. He gave you what it is that he wants you to handle. Our problem is we quit looking at what's in our hand, trying to peep what's in somebody else's. The Bible says he preached this kind of stuff to the people, and the Bible says they hated the master and they didn't do anything with it, and life slaughtered them. So let me fast forward and tell you that this message is about the power of being properly connected, first of all, to God, and then secondly, to each other. And you'll see it in a minute. Literally, we must be connected to the right, this, the right God and the right people of God. I know it might sound like a broken record, but in this season, you got false people, false gods and false people of God. See, I can help, but I can't align myself with people who are amassed in syncretism. Okay, Bishop, what is syncretism? I can't be a little bit of Muslim, a little bit of Jehovah Witness, a little bit of Buddhist, a little bit of Christian, and a little bit of karma, and a little bit of this, and a little bit of that. Somebody say the devil is a liar. You wouldn't even drink nothing like that. All these Long Island iced tea Christians. It got everything, and now you're wondering why you're sick at night. It got everything, and either pick the liquor you gonna drink or don't drink. I didn't know that. I used to drink Long Island iced tea all the time. And so me and Cam went to get breakfast one day, and the lady said, would you like anything to drink? And I was playing with her. I said, you got Long Island iced tea? And she said, oh, yeah. Cam said, what, Dad? I said, I'm just playing. He said, you know, I said, I don't even know what's in that. Cam said, everything. How you know? But I said, no wonder. I used to toss and turn. I'm drinking. And that's what's happening to so many Christians. Every time you're trying to walk with God, you wobbly and you throwing up what's in you. Why? Because you're trying to drink everything. You can't swallow everything in the name of God. Somebody say Christ or bust. And he wasn't just the prophet. He's the Messiah. He is God. That's the special revelation of the Bible. In the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Ghost. In the name of our Lord. In Jesus' name. Somebody say, Jesus is God. That's why we don't have power. That's why we're not filled with the Holy Ghost. Because we don't believe it right. You can't live as a Christian in depression for a long time. You're not supposed to live as a Christian with confusion for a long time. Jesus, who is our wisdom, he's the Prince of Peace. He gives us unspeakable joy. Things will come because we're human. Things are come because we're in this flesh, but it's not supposed to stay, somebody say, for a long time. And God, that's why God has connected us to people, because sometimes your anointing don't kick in like it's supposed to. And I need to be around some people whose anointing might kick in when mine not. And see, when we connect right, see, I ain't got to worry about what Pam's past is if you anoint it now. First of all, who gives a flip about your past if you anoint it now? And then here go the real deal. Watch this, elder. Your history might help me with my future. Ah, good God Almighty. If I know where you come from and I see God doing that for you, it might change the trajectory of my future. My whole expectation might change. You went through that and you acting like this? Well, good God Almighty, why am I tripping? Let me take off this sackcloth and ashes. Let me take off these robes. Let me get back into the oil of gladness. Let me get back to a place that ain't mad about praising the Lord. Let me get around some folk that don't mind running up and down the aisle. Don't let me get around some people that don't mind leaping and jumping. Don't let me get around some folk that'll get baptized again. Let me get around some people who know their God and they're ready to do what God called them to do. Let me go ahead and rush hell with a water pistol. I want to be around some people that love my God. My wife was going through this weekend and I knew I had to leave. And so I prayed. Yesterday I said, God, she needs some favor. She believed God. She took some money and said, I just sent some money to Bishop, and I just sold and told him my family needs some favor. And I said, God, it's like scared to talk to that girl all them years. If she would just wink at me, I would know I got it going on. So God, I don't always need you to fix it all right now. This is my prayer. But every now and then, I just need you to wink at me. Just let me know that you checking me out while I'm checking you out. And at the right time, I'll put my silk on it. But I just need to know that you paying attention to me while I'm paying attention to you. I said, God, my wife needs to know that you paying attention to her. And today, he winked at her in court. And then today, he winked at her at the hospital. And the baby opened his eyes and grabbed her fingers. He can't come home yet, but God done winked at her. You know why? Because he's paying attention. Tell somebody, just wink at me. Just wink. I don't need a lot in this season. I'm mature. I'm a big boy. I just need to know that you're watching me. Watch you, God. If you would just wink at me, I know it's going to be all right. How many in here need a wink from God tonight? You just need God to just do something to let you know he's paying attention. You know he's God and you know he loves you. But it's just been hard sometimes, and it's just been a little confusing sometimes. And sometimes I feel a little discombobulated because don't nobody else understand what I'm going through. God, I know this is you, but everybody's trying to tell me that it's not. If you would just wink at me tonight. God wants us to know and understand what it means. That's why we need each other, y'all. I was tired, but I needed to preach tonight. Not for you, but for me. I needed to say something that I could hear in a voice that I can trust. I need to hear it from the Holy Ghost coming through my mouth. And I don't know if there's one of y'all out here that needed to hear anything that I said. I dare you to just give God something right there. Because God is saying there's just times when we need each other to be able to speak to each other. See, because it's possible, and I'm almost done, it's possible to have great determination and horrible discernment. Man of God, who is a professional millionaire, need to meet me. He said, I need to meet you. I need to see you right now. He getting ready to meet with millionaires in December, ex-NFL, ex-NBA, guys with all kind of money, women who have played soccer, just all kind of, he's an athlete, former athlete from Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt, that's interesting. And he said, I need to talk to you. What you want to ask me? He said, man, I got this retreat I'm doing, and I'm doing A, B, C, D, and E. Okay. He said, but God told me not to move any further until you prayed about it. I need to make sure my ambition ain't getting in the way of my discernment. So I need to not let my determination be so high that I run off into something that God don't want me to do. And you called this ex-crack addict and said, I want you to pray about it and see what God says to you. And whatever God says to you, then that's what I'm willing to do. I wanted to run up and down the parking lot, not because he chose me, not because I'm getting ready to do something special, but it just showed me how much God cares about us, that he doesn't even want our determination to get in the way of our discernment. It just reminded me that we need one another. I can't even leave you with these nine principles because God told me to share something with you. You got to do a better job of vetting people. Too many times we just let them in our midst for a season instead of a reason. And now they've cost us more than they were even worth. And the bad part about us is keeping them around is draining us, But we think if we get rid of them, it's going to expose us. I come to bring somebody some freedom tonight. I feel like a Baptist preacher. I feel like I got a word. Gone and let them go. Let them kill you. Because if they kill you, God will raise you up. You scared of dying, but if you don't die, you can't resurrect. Don't hold on to nothing that's going to drain you. Gone and let them kill you and watch God raise you up. Somebody say right connection. Here's something my bishop told me. I think I've said it in MIT several times, and it's on the screen. The greatest reason for the worst season of your life and the best season of your life has always been a person or persons attached to it. Your worst season and your best season has always had a person or persons attached to it. See, and your ability, listen, your ability to endure to go through any storm in life, listen, it comes from outside of yourself. Everybody talking about intestinal fortitude. Yeah, you got to have some guts. You got to have some faith to get through it, but it's been what's outside of you that's helped you endure. If I had time, I'd sing Lean On Me right now. When you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'm gonna do this and let you go. There are some principles about synergy that we need to learn, and I may have her put them on the screen while I'm praying. But there's nine principles about synergy that you got to learn. But listen, Bishop was preaching the other day, and God gave me a revelation, and I heard it again last night, and God told me to write it down, so I'm gonna do it. Mark chapter 4, verse 35 through 39. Somebody say connections. And the Bible says, and the same day when the even was come, he saith unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. Now, Jesus was speaking to everybody that was with him, but he wasn't speaking to everybody. Did y'all hear that? He was speaking to everybody that was with him, but he wasn't speaking to everybody. Watch this, because watch what happens. And when they had sent away the multitude. See, the one thing that I learned last night and when I heard it, when you stick with and follow the word, you pass over. Somebody say it, it came to pass. When you stick with and follow the word, you pass over. Because he said, let us go over until the other side. Not let's swim, let's try. He said, let us go. Somebody say go. And when they had sent away the multitude, see, when you're going with the anointing, everybody doesn't get to go. That's how you know you're in the anointing, because folk that ain't in the anointing and ain't part of your destiny, they don't get to go with you no further. You might come back and get them one day, but right now they don't get to go. Hey, me and my son gonna go up into the mountain and we're gonna worship. And the Bible says Abraham told the lads, we'll be back. Look at somebody and say, I'll be back. Every now and then, when you're following the anointing, folk you've been following with and running with don't get to go. The Bible says they took him even as he was. I want to work that right there. But in the ship. Somebody say in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. One translation said other ships followed along the way. And years ago I preached about relationship, but then I preached about the other little ships, like fellowship and fellowship and discipleship. Because there's other little ships that were with him. But watch this. But here's the revelation. Jesus said, in order to be with the anointing, I don't necessarily have to be on the boat. I just need to be on the journey. because sometimes when we get too close to the anointing, familiarity breeds contempt. And sometimes the Bible says for Joshua, y'all need to be a few feet back from the word of God because you ain't never been this way before. And I need you to follow the word, but I don't need you to be in the boat with it. See, because sometimes we will pervert the proximity of our purpose. See, we'll be so close to the anointing that we'll get caught up in something else and we'll forget and lose the real purpose of us being close with one another. And so I don't need you in my boat. I just need you on my journey. And that's why the power of connection says you ain't even got to be in my boat, Levi. You just got to be on my journey. Somebody say, come ride with me. And watch this. And the Bible says, and there arose a great storm of wind. The NIV calls it a furious squall. And the Bible says, and the waves beat into the ship. See, you got folk always complaining that they ain't never invited and they ain't in the in group. Well, how do you know that God wasn't protecting you from being that close because the ship you wanted to get in was getting ready to get full of water? You begging and jealous about being in a sinking ship. And how do you even know that your faith is strong enough to handle this ship? Because when the ship starts sinking, your crazy tail might jump out and get ate up by a shark. God protected you. I'm getting ready to beat into this ship, and you couldn't handle this beating. I hear what my bishop is going through, and my wife said, you going to go over to the bishop's house today? You going to go see the bishop? He under attack. The enemy's after him. I'm going to pray from afar. I'm on the journey, but I ain't in the boat. I don't know if I'm ready for that type of beating yet. That's why the Bible says don't think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. You can't always handle the beating that your pastor is going through. You can't handle the water that's coming in your bishop's ship. You can't handle the hell that I'm catching. Keep your tail back there and just stay on the journey. You worried about who in my boat? This is a season where you couldn't handle this beating. So why, watch this, the Bible says, so that it was now full. And that's why you need to pray for your leader. Because, watch this, the boat was full, but the wind and the rain, they wasn't after the boys. They was after Jesus. That's why you got to pray for your leader, because you don't know what they're going through. While he's asleep on the boat, the wind and the rain thought they could sneak up on him and drown him while he was asleep on the pillow. They thought they could soak his head underwater to where he couldn't hear God. But how in the world you going to use water to keep Jesus from hearing himself when himself made the water? All you did was put him back in the place where he started before, because it wasn't nothing but water from the beginning. But the enemy don't know that. So the boys say, oh my God, master, cares not that we perish? The Bible says he arose, rebuked the wind, and said unto the sea, peace. In one translation, he said, hush. In another translation, he said, silence. In another translation, he said, quiet. Be still. And the Bible says, and the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. All I want to say to you is when you're properly connected, when the anointing moves, it impacts everybody. Jesus spoke and the wind and the waves obeyed. But watch this. When you're connected properly, he didn't just calm the waters in the boat. He calmed the waters on the waters. So when the anointing moves, you ain't got to be in the boat. You just got to be on the water. See, so somebody said, well, I got 2 weeks ago, somebody said, well, Bishop, are you sure you're supposed to be in Florida? Last week, friend moved to Jacksonville, and they said, man, I bet they miss you in Dayton after I preach for Bishop. Today I got a text and say, huh? You need to be here and there.
Can I tell you, somebody say, I'm connected. Can I tell you that when you're connected properly, you ain't got to be in the boat. You just got to be in the water. And when you're in the water, whatever Jesus say to the water, if it was storming for him, it was storming for them. Remember, other little ships followed him. So when the storm took off, it wasn't just affecting his boat, it was affecting their boat. But when Jesus stood up, somebody say he stood up. See, that's what he did for Stephen. When Stephen was getting stoned, Stephen said, listen, into thy hands I commit this, my spirit. He said, forgive him. And the Bible says that Jesus stood up on the right hand of the Father. All throughout the text, we see him sitting on the right hand of the Father. But there's times when Jesus will stand up. The Bible says he arose and he rebuked the wind and the rain. And I just believe that in this season, God uses mouths. He used the mouth of a jackass in Samson's hand and beat the Philistines. So he'll do the same thing now. He'll use the mouth of a jackass to speak to some people. And I didn't come to speak to my boat. I come to speak to your water tonight. So whatever's ruffling your water tonight, if you got ruffles in your water, I dare you to stand up and lift your hands. I come to speak to your water tonight. I come to say, peace be still. I come to say, be quiet. I come to say, silence. I come to say, hush. I come to say, shut up to the waters and every wave that's trying to beat against your boat tonight. Because we're connected. Because you're properly connected to your leader, that when the leader speaks, when the anointing speaks, it doesn't just speak to his boat, but it speaks to the water. Every ship that was with him was saved. And just like with Joshua, everybody went over to the other side. I'm just believing that there's another side that God wants to take us to tonight. But Bishop, what was your point? My point is stay connected. See, because it's easy to get connected. It's hard to stay connected. I'm so amazed about the people that can just walk away. That can just no longer give a darn. And what's even worse, they don't even have no place that they really call it home. And they really don't have a reason why they're disconnected. They just disconnected and don't know what's going on. But I'm so thankful tonight that I'm not disconnected. I'm this connected. That when my bishop's in a season of attack, some of the waters might be rough for me, Pam, but even if I ain't in the boat, I'm not leaving the water, because in a minute, bishop's going to stand up. In a minute, the Lord's going to stand up. In a minute, the anointing's going to stand up, and it's not going to speak to his boat, but it's going to speak to the water. And the winds have to obey. God is calling us into another place of accountability. Tonight, just like Jonathan and David, there was a connection. Can you imagine being connected to the man that's getting ready to take your throne? His daddy was king. The throne was supposed to belong to him, but he saw something on David and he said, listen, here's what I need you to do. I'm not going to be king, you're going to be king, but I need you to remember my son. And the Bible talks about Mephibosheth, who David called to the table and said, oh no, you from the house of Saul. My boy Jonathan, I know your granddaddy tried to kill me, but your daddy was cool with me. And because I was connected to him, I'm connected to you. And I know that you lame on your feet, but this is what we're going to do. We're going to put you on the table. We're going to put the skirt on your legs. Ain't nobody even going to know you lame. And on top of all that, I'm going to give you your own land and your own people to take care of you. How many of you just believe that God's going to give you your own land? He's going to give you your own purpose. And the things that you're deficient in, he's going to cover it with the glory of God. Ain't nobody going to know you lame in your emotions. Ain't nobody going to know you lame in your doubt, in your faith. Ain't nobody going to know you lame in different places in your life, because God's got you covered. That's what Adam learned. He said, I hid because I was naked. Who told you? Who told you you was naked? God wants to cover you. Hidden treasures from secret places because I'm connected. Pam, give me 5 minutes. How wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers live together in harmony. For harmony is as precious as the anointing oil that was poured over Aaron's head and ran down his beard and onto the border of the robe. Harmony is as refreshing as the dew from Mount Hermon that falls on the mountains of Zion. Watch this. And where there's harmony, somebody say, and there. And there the Lord has pronounced his blessing, even life everlasting. It's called functional synergy. It's almost 2023. This is the year we got to walk in it, y'all. I'm talking about as disciples of Christ, we got to begin to see the fruit of God's promises and work God's principles. I believe this is going to be the great exhibition and appearance of answered prayers and prophetic expectations. It's going to come with responsibility, though. And we've got to honor and serve him. We can't do our own thing and then try to use God like a genie. But if we do what God is asking us to do, if we try to serve humanity, if we allow ourselves to worship him and to put him first, there is no limit to what God wants to do for us. He owns cattle on a thousand hills. There's contracts and grants. They coming at me so fast. My wife said, are you going to fill that grant out? And I told her, yeah. But I just had to get the Project Cure today and just breathe, because they come in so fast and everybody keeps saying yes. And the money keeps coming so fast. And I don't get to pocket the money, but I have to steward the money. And the devil wants you to jack something up. I had somebody, a contract killer, he called me last night and he said, man, we watching you, dog. Don't mess up. We need you, man. You the hope shot for the niggas in the hood. This was Zach words. He said, we ain't never seen nobody like you. You move like one of us, but then you move like you ain't one of us. We can tell you something different. He said, listen, dog, I got the text. He said, lean back, but don't relax while you in the city, dog. Because they waiting on you to blow this thing. But we need you. He said, I ain't had nobody get in my face in love and tell me what I needed to hear. I was paid to eliminate jokers like you. Don't jack this up for us. We need to get right, but we ain't ready yet. But if we can hold on to you. And I said, man, some of the places I walk and some of the things I do, I'm just going to have to be honest with me. You can't be in my boat with me just because of some of the ways I got to move. I said, but guess what? You in the water, dog. You might not be in the boat, but you in the water. And if you just stay close enough on the journey, whatever I speak to the water, it's going to touch your boat. And then who knows? I might have to turn the boat over to you one day, because we don't know what God's going to do. You got to be around people you can trust. Even in your vulnerable moments, there need to be people you can trust. Folk that got as much to lose as you do. Or be like, you'll never call back. I can't right now. It ain't always I'm anointed, so I got to wait until I feel the anointing to call you back. I don't know what it is you're going to ask me. I don't know what it is you're going to say to me. I need to be in the spirit right now. Oh, it took me 50-something years to get that way, but somebody say, he that way now, though. He that way now. I don't diss nobody. I don't dislike anybody. I got love for everybody. Sometimes I just don't have time for everybody. I told a group, I'm over discipleship, outreach, and evangelism at the Potter's House, one of the most prominent churches in America. Me? Sometimes I walk in staff meeting, I just be looking around, I just be crying. I mean, we've got national recording artists leading our worship, and national recording artists, the youth pastor, and folk that's just done this, and people that's done that, and army generals, and all these people sitting in the room, and me. I said, God, just let me stay in the water. I may not get to go to Africa no more with Bishop. I may not go to Australia. I may not get to be side by side with him. I see him taking the other pastors. My wife says, well, he don't call you. I said, listen, we ain't tripping on the boat, baby. We We don't trip on the boat. I don't need that. That's the one good thing about being a McGuire. You know, you thought you had it, but you was enough by yourself anyway. So that attitude come up every now and then when the devil try to make you jealous or something, you'd be like, no, you know what? I ain't missing them. They missing me. But in my humility, in my spirit, it's like, God, I don't even know what that boat requires right now. I got enough on me. I don't need that boat. But if he called me, somebody say, he ain't scared. He ain't scared. But it's about having the proper connections. Harmony means congruity. It means being together. It means being unified. It means having the right characteristics and perspectives. And I'm just going to throw them on the screen. Are you up there? Are they ready? And I'm going to give these to you, then we're going to pray. Number one, don't forget the big picture perspective. This is not about you. Real harmony and unity gives you the big picture. Are we ready? Number two, it's called organized functionality. This is when I don't need no recognition, Pam. It's when I can sing the song and don't nobody remember it was me. They just remember the words. I can preach the message. Don't nobody remember I came. Somebody preached last Thanksgiving. I don't even remember who it was, but they said something. This is when I'm responsible without being territorial. I'm the director of outreach, but it ain't my outreach. Bishop was doing it before I got there. He don't need me. He's blessing me. This is when you be moved. Number three, moved with conviction. Listen, this is when you're in covenant with the vision. You can't be under something and got your own. Why would you live in my house and you own one? If your vision bigger than this house, then go get your house. But if it's not and it can get submitted to the vision, then follow the vision. Just follow the vision. Your time is coming. You don't have to force it. The frustration come in forcing it. See, because if I got to force it, that's rape anyway. That's illegal in the spirit. Number four, performance-based positioning. I want God to use me in my highest and best use for right now. It might shift. I can't always be that. I was the youth pastor. I was doing a decent job. The folks love me. The kids love me. I got it organized. I got it right. Bishop said, I'm taking it to another level. I'm taking it to another dimension. I need somebody younger, somebody with a bigger name. I need somebody that does something else with worship. I ain't mad at you. I'm going to move you. You're not getting demoted. You're getting promoted. Not because my position is bigger than that. It's just because when God does it, whenever God repositions you, whenever God replaces you, it's a promotion because God did it. We so worried about a freaking title that we forgot to take our towel with us in the first place. You worried about titles and all your towels are dry. Ain't a wet towel, ain't a dirty towel, ain't an anointed towel in your house. Ain't none of them been used. What's the use of having a Tommy Hilfiger towel if you ain't gonna take a shower? The anointing need to be dripping off of you. Somebody, when I'm done with my towel, it ought to smell like something. There ought to be something all over my towel. Why? Because it's anointed now. The Bible says Paul and them gave out their handkerchiefs. They tore them up. Why? Because it was anointed. It's a shame to have a title and no towel. Shame that people call you something, but they don't see you doing nothing. Don't have to wait. Don't have to wait for somebody to say you over evangelism. We was already on the block, and ain't nobody said nothing to me. I bought the tracks with my money, and I went to the block. I drove around in the dark. Wait on somebody to give you a title, and then up jump Skippy. He said, you over evangelism. Well, ain't that something? God give you a title after he's seen your title. If your passion for doing it ain't there, why we need to give you the position? I'm going to make it hard on somebody not to want me to be a part of ministry because I'm going to be ministry. I don't do ministry. I am ministry. If praise is what I is who he was, then ministry is who I am. Watch this. Grace trumps talent. And you don't get it because you're talented. You get it because you're anointed. Grace trumps that. Go where you're graced. And pastor, it's okay if they say, I ain't graced to do this no more. The answer is hallelujah. What do you believe you're graced to do? Whatever it is you believe you're graced to do, do it. But we ain't got to say it yet. Number five, the law of unity. You got to avoid discord. I ain't being around nobody that's messy. I'm not talking to nobody that's sowing discord. I'm not hanging with this clique. If all we're going to do is sit around and talk to each other, we all going to hell. So somebody need to pray right now. Somebody need to get anointed. Somebody need to fix this. I'm tired of us sitting around talking about the other people at the church that worship at the same place we do and call the same bishop father. And then when we get in his face, we act like we love him and love each other. And then we tearing each other down. Don't we think he got enough discernment to know we lying? I done told the elders, I done been here before, and I said they in there lying. They don't love me because they don't love each other. Ain't nowhere in the world we could have loved Betty Jane, and me and Chris had a problem. We got the same mammy. We sucked off the same breast. Ain't nowhere in the world we got the same milk. Ain't nowhere in the world we was gonna be at odds. Yeah, I'ma say it. That's my nigga. That's my boy. That's my cat. That's my dog. That's my best friend in a man form. That's my dude. I'ma have a problem with my brother. Now put that in the spirit. Betty Jane ain't saved neither one of us. She ain't died for neither one of us. She ain't rose again for neither one of us. But Jesus did. And if Jesus made Mike my brother, how in the world I got a problem with Mike that me and Mike can't fix and we serve the same daddy? It's the same El Shaddai. He's the same big-breasted one. If me and Chris can be good, how can we not be good when we really brothers? The law of unity. I don't think God gonna bless you with your discord itself. The Bible says six things does the Lord hate, seven is an abomination, and the seventh thing is them that sow discord among the brethren. If you make me not like them, you ain't right. People need to repent of that mess. Number six is confidentiality. If God gives you the privilege of privacy, why are you telling everybody else's business? Come on, some of y'all sitting here tonight, the Holy Ghost showed me a couple of people. If I exposed what you was thinking, wouldn't nobody sit on your row? Some things got said because of what you was thinking. Number seven, fat excellence. Bible says the Lord will make you fat. So y'all know I'm with the Lord. Y'all know I'm with God. I'm with him. But when he talks about fat, he means full of favor. And for us, fat means faithful, accountable, and teachable. Sit your tail down. Bishop is talking, I don't open my mouth. I'm taking notes. That's the teacher. That's the sage. The dust of the rabbi is upon me because I try to stay close enough to hear what he's saying. I catch the dust of the rabbi. Sometimes people are teaching and preaching. You doing too much talking. Hush, you the wind and the wave. You the storm in somebody else's life while they trying to hear the word of God. Number eight, connectivity. And that's the whole point. Number nine, call it RR&R, revisiting, retooling, and reorganizing. Every now and then, you just need to revisit. 2 Corinthians said, hey, test your own faith and see if it's genuine. And if it's not, fix it. And number 10, this is where a lot of people missing their blessings right here. I ain't moving until it's on the screen. This is where a lot of people missing their blessings. We got to learn how to focus on the main thing. We got to learn respect and honor. We got to learn the traits of Shem and Japheth. See, Ham went in and just wanted to tell everything he knew. Shem and Japheth walked backwards. You know why? Because they knew what had been covering them gonna need to cover them. And so you so worried about what ain't and what ain't. What if their midnight prayer has been getting you through? Because they've got the heart of God. They might not do things. I might not have done things the way you wanted me to do it, but I knew how to pray for you. I knew how to get on my face. I knew how to consecrate. I knew how to get a word from the Lord that would bless your life. And then here it is. You want to come in facing me? You should have backed in when you came in my room. Because the same thing that's been covering you, going to have to cover you again. So number 10 is cover your leadership. Why would you hurt the one that's been sent to nurture you, feed you, mature you, protect you? Watch this. And to help you, not make you happy, but to help. So Pam can go get her dressing. I want to touch hands with some people who want to be connected properly. Listen, your coming up here don't mean you wasn't connected properly, but you want the strength of not ever being lured by the enemy to not be connected properly. If that's you, just all we gonna do is just clench hands real quick. And we just gonna clench hands real quick. I'm talking about proper connection. I'm talking about connected to an anointing that when it speaks to the water, you don't even have to be in the boat. It calms your seas. Could you imagine that the people in the other ships didn't even hear what Jesus said, but all of a sudden they saw a vision, they saw an image stand up in the boat, and something was said, and all of a sudden the water stopped and the wind ceased and all of their panic went away, and they saw the other men on the boat shouting, and they had to know that it was something about what was on that boat. It was something about that was in that water that calmed their seas. I just believe that proper connection changes everything. Auntie, it changes everything. And God has a plan for our lives, but it can't happen without proper connection. Listen, you cannot prevail on your own. You cannot prevail on your own. It's going to take somebody. 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 It's going to take, Uncle, I love you. I love you, Uncle Milty. I love you. It's going to take somebody. Proud of you. It's going to take somebody. Come on. Come on. Get over here. You looking. You looking. You looking. It's going to take somebody. Proper connection to the anointing. Unity in the body. With God, harmony and unity. God is commanding. He didn't just speak it, he's commanding the blessing. Today, if you just believe there's a commanded blessing in store for you, let's dismiss this way. You're going to give and go when I'm done. When I'm done, you're just going to come give your offering and you're gone. And we're going to be dismissed. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come in the spirit of unity tonight. We come in the spirit of divine connection tonight. We come in the spirit of oneness and harmony tonight. On this Thanksgiving, we are so grateful that we're not disconnected. We thank God that we're this connected, that you're doing something special in us. You are recharging us, refueling us. And God, where we've fallen off, where we've become somewhat disconnected and disarrayed and discombobulated, God, you're mending it tonight. God, we're going to walk in forgiveness. We're going to walk in love. We're going to walk in hope. We're going to walk in expectation. And God, we are trusting that 2023 is waiting on us, that there's a door, that there's a portal, that there's a threshold that's away awaiting our obedience, that God, you're going to catapult us into the next dimension of your glory and the grace and the blessings that you have for us. We're not just going to walk in it, but we're going to be able to march in it because you've commanded it. And so, God, we thank you. We honor you. We love you. Bless Pastor Moss and Isabel tonight, the leaders of this local assembly, God. Bless them like never before. Take care of those boys. Take care of their sister, God. Take care of the family, God. And whoever is in the boat, let them not panic because the anointing is with them. But God, if those that want to ride can't get in the boat, let them come along on the journey because you're taking everybody to the other side. And whatever that is, we declare it tonight that we're going to get to the other side. We love you, sir. On this Thanksgiving Eve, thank you for family and gathering and love and excitement and fun and all of that. Bless my wife back in Jacksonville and her sons and daughter, God. Just thank you. Thank you for Cam and MC and Christina and Alex. And just thank you, God, for those you've given me charge over, God, spiritually and even naturally, God. Thank you for the Potter's House and Bishop and Lady and the Jackson family and Memphis and the McLaughlins. All around, God, we just thank you for the Joneses, God. We thank you for G. Joyce and the family. God, I thank you for connection, God. Every right connection, every right connection, every right connection, God. I would not be able without it. I love you, sir. We need you. Thank you for every gift that's sown tonight. Thank you for every offering, every tithe that's given, God, for the upbuilding of your kingdom. We love you, sir. And to everyone here tonight, happy Thanksgiving. And we thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's just give God some praise as you give and go. Come on, play something up there so they can give and go. Hallelujah. We love you. Pastor, we love you. God bless you. Happy Thanksgiving. Tomorrow at what time? 11 o'clock tomorrow. If you don't have anywhere to go, or even if you do, stop by. Let's have a little break, a little bread together. Let's just sop in. Let's do the old custom where we sop inside the gravy. I bite it, then we sop back, and then you bite it. No, I'm just kidding. Let's just have a good time tomorrow and play it. I just need some music, any kind of marching music, anything. Kirk Franklin, Snoop Dogg, something. We just need something that we can rock to. Something. Hallelujah. Come on, it's hard to give in silence. They're going to make me sing. There we go. Turn it on up. Come on, turn it on up. Greens, tomatoes, chicken, turkey, greens, tomatoes, ham. What'd she say? There we go. Come on.
That all things work together for my good, homie.